While we're waiting, I thought I would just take this opportunity to introduce myself for those of you who may not know me. I'm Demario Carter, and right now I'm residing in the state of Kansas. And first of all, I want to bring you greetings from my brethren there, and especially from my wife. She told me to greet several people, to hug a few of you. So especially right now, I want to give you greetings from her to all of you right now. Of course, especially as we began to come here, she really wanted to come, but she's holding down things back at the fort, if you will. And she's going to be handling things at our church there while me and my son are here. So I'd like to send you greetings from her. And again, I'm with the Council of Prophecy Ministries. And our official name is the Council of Prophecy Seventh-day Protestant Church. And we are a fairly new church. But God is blessing as we take one step at a time. And the reason why we wanted to emphasize the fact that we are Protestants, because we are. You know, Protestantism has been dead. Yes, Protestants. Yeah, that's the correct way, I guess. Protestants, and because we speak against sin and against corruption, against abuses of the fallen churches in our land and abroad. And so we want to hold up the banner high of present truth that God has given to us. And if we're not holding up the banner high in our own hearts, we can't expect to hold it high where we are in the public, in the view of the people. So may God help us to hold up the banner high. This is one of our recent, our latest newsletters, fairly old now, the April, May. I have a few copies left for those of you who haven't received one. It's just a simple little newsletter that we put out. We try to put one out monthly, but sometimes it's bi-monthly. I have a few left, as well as a few DVDs. This one, there's one over there that goes into a little bit about the history of the iceberg that is among us. The Adventist iceberg is called, and the simple truth about Jesus. And then one of my latest one was the parable of the 10 virgins. So I just wanted to point those out to you. And there are a few of them over here if you would like to have some. If you are unacquainted with the work that we're doing there, you can go to our website, thecouncilofprophecy.com, and sign up for our newsletters there. So trust that God will lead each and every one of us as we seek his plan for us, as we seek his will. I guess I'm supposed to turn this on, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
It may not come up automatically, but it has a good chance to.
Okay, I just pressed the power.
Lined up for you.
There we go. Yeah.
Brother DeMario.
Yes.
Somebody asked, what was the name of your church again?
The Council of Prophecy, Seventh-day Protestant Church. And you can go to thecouncilofprophecy.com. We have a few things on our website, not much materials. It's still a work in building, but we have some things there. And you can also watch our live streams. We live stream our Sabbath services there as well. If you know of someone who may not be able to meet in a local group, those services are available. As you know, they're available here through Smyrna as well. So as you see here, before I go on, let me just see if there's anything else I'm forgetting. I want to make sure I have all my little preliminaries. And by the way, I may not make it through all of this. What time do I have to? You know? 12:15? Okay, 12:15. If I don't make it through all my slides, I have another opportunity to share some things with you. But before we do go into our study today, I think we need to spend some time in prayer. And I think we need to spend some time in prayer. Even if I don't get through all my slides, it would be useless if God is not impressing us by his Holy Spirit. But not just what I'm going to share today, but what you've been hearing throughout this week so far and what you are to hear still. That God will help us to take and internalize these messages and put them into practice in our own lives. And that at the same time, we will be medical missionaries to go forth to reach our fellow men and women with this precious gospel that we have been given. It would be a shame for us to get to the bar of judgment and to find that because of our selfishness, which we call fear, of wanting to share, because of that selfishness, we will find ourselves lost. Now that may sound harsh, but we need to consider the reality. Christ tells us to love our neighbors as ourselves. And that is actually a high calling because of self, because of this sinful nature. So we need to spend some time in prayer asking for God's blessing, asking for His power, asking that we may be renewed, transformed, and changed, asking that our conversations that we have amongst ourselves will be uplifting, asking that we will be right representatives of the message that we have been given. And especially do I appeal to that to us as leaders here, those of you leaders. The examples that we must be setting for both young and old is so critical. Amen. And I don't know about you, but I want this work to be finished. Amen. It will not be finished if we are still half-hearted. God wants full of us, full-hearted individuals. And those things that we are dealing with in ourselves, the sin, the secret sins that we're dealing with, we must be striving against until we at last gain the victory. Do you believe that? Amen. So we're going to spend a moment, if you will, in prayer, and we're going to launch into our message. So if you are able to, I'll ask you to kneel, and I'm going to have a moment of silence for you to pray. And pray for yourselves. Pray for me, especially as I share what God has given. Pray for the Holy Spirit, even the latter rain. Let us pray. Father in heaven, in the stillness of this time, we hear your voice. Even now, through that bird that is out there, singing praises to your name, giving you honor and glory for your creative power. And here we are, gathered as creatures who've been made in your own image, and yet so full of self, so full with troubles and problems that we can barely praise you. We can barely experience that joy that you so desire for us to have, that joy that gives us strength. We're filled with so many troubles and complications, stresses of life, and we need liberty. We need peace. We need power. We need a change. We need revival. And Father, we know that you are aware of our needs, but help us to be aware and to present them before you until we gain the victory. We ask as we go into our study now for the power of your Spirit. Enlighten our eyes, open them that we may behold wondrous things from thy law. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Amen. Of course, when dealing with a subject such as dress reform, it is impossible to cover every aspect of it in one or two settings. So what we're going to be covering in the two times that I will speak is very basic and simple and perhaps not even scratching the surface, if you will. And as I was preparing for camp meeting, I was thinking of how I may have to set some time apart in the future to do a series on this subject, because there is so much involved, as those of you who have studied the subject of dress understand. So we would just look at some simple things that would not be exhaustive. So there may be points that you think is so critical that I failed to mention. Well, you can still come and talk to me about them, ask questions, or talk to someone else about them. We're at liberty to discuss these things with one another. But I just want to inform you of that. There will be things that I will not bring out because I don't have all week to present them. But can you bring my Bible, brother? Right there, yes. Well, we're going to start off in the Bible, and we're going to go to a text that I often consider as perfect vision. Now, when you go to an optometrist and you get your eyes checked, and if they say your vision is 20/20, you're happy. You have good vision, perhaps even perfect. And this is a text I often remember because of its 20/20 and how it has to do with vision. And that's in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 20. That's where we're going to start off at this time. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 20. I want to start off with this simple principle that may not be directly related to health, but it is something for us to consider, especially for those who may be listening right now that may be struggling with the whole ideal of God and His inspiration and all that He has taught us and all that He has revealed to us, the messages that He has given even through inspiration. So here is 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 20. This is a well-known passage, and I'll just read the end of that text because that's the point that I want to drive. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall ye be established. Believe His prophets, so shall ye prosper. So we're told to believe in the Lord our God so that we may be established, that we may be firm, settled, immovable, unshakable. And to believe in His prophets so that we can prosper or succeed. And of course, this ends up talking about material things here. Prosper in Christ. Prosper in a victorious life. Prosper in the purpose and the plan and His will for your life. We will not be able to prosper without a thus saith the Lord. And I don't know about you, but I believe that a thus saith the Lord was communicated to us as the remnant people in this remnant movement through the writings of Sister White. Amen. So we are going to be considering some of her writings. Because I don't know about you, but I want to believe in His prophets so that I can prosper.
Amen.
There may be some who don't want to hear the pen of inspiration quoted or spoken from the pulpit or from the desk. But that to me is similar to saying that we don't need the Word of God. Now, it is not as if I exalt Ellen White above the Bible. But I understand the importance of it. And I saw how God was leading in the movement of the early movement of Adventism and how God had inspired our prophet. And so for me, I want all that God wants to give. Especially in such a degenerate age that we now live in, we need all the help that God wants to give us. All the help that He wants to give us. So we need to believe in His prophets so that we can prosper.
Mary,
yes.
She qualified that statement, you know, where she said not to use Ellen White on the desk until you get yourself solid in Scripture.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. And she also mentioned that every point of our faith should be proven from where? If you use primarily Ellen White to prove your doctrines, you're in trouble. Because you can come before the courts and legislations and all day long and say, I think it says in the Bible, but I know Ellen White said, it's not going to work. You had better know your Bibles and be able to prove every point. In fact, I don't think I have quotations here, but she mentions how God has given us in His Bible general principles, and He has given the testimonies to shed light or to be the specifics to help us understand the general principles. So we need to understand the place that both the Bible and the writings of Ellen White has to do in, which I both consider the spirit of prophecy, by the way. This is what she has to say. In ancient times, God spoke to men by the mouth of his prophets and apostles. In these last days, He speaks to them by what? The testimonies of His Spirit. There was never a time when God instructed His people more earnestly not in the days of Moses, not in the days of Abraham. Am I talking too loud? Or? Oh, okay. I saw you.
Now.
Oh, I see, yes. There was never a time when God has given more instructions, instructed his people more earnestly than he instructs them when? Now. Concerning his will and the course that he would have them pursue. To me, that shows the fact that not that God is partial or a respecter of persons, but that he sees that things will happen in the last days and that his people will need to be thoroughly equipped to deal with the delusions and the falsehoods and the apostasy that would exist. And so he has given us an abundance of light to help us in our dull minds to navigate through all the darkness and to stay on a path of present truth. God is either teaching his church, reproving their wrongs, or strengthening their faith, or he is not. This work is of God, or it is not. And she's referring to her own. So either the writings of Sister White is of God, or it's of the devil. There is no in-between. And we need to settle in our minds what spirit was behind these writings. And be settled in the truth. Believe his prophets that you may prosper. Gold on my work for the past 30 years bears the stamp of God or the stamp of the enemy. There is no halfway work in the matter. The testimonies are of the Spirit of God or of the devil. And again, God is either teaching his church, reproving their wrongs. I'm sorry, I already read that. Well, let's go on to the next one. Another reason, the bottom. Another reason which I offer as an apology for calling attention again to the subject of dress is that not one in 20 of the sisters who profess to believe the testimonies has taken the first step in dress reform. Not one in 20. And I'm going to have you hold that thought for a moment because I'm going to share something here in a few slides that will hopefully bring you back into balance, because this may cause you to be a little defensive right now. First of all, we need to recognize in dealing with dress and its relations to health, where does that change need to take place? Change must be within. And let's go to Matthew chapter 23, as Jesus brought out this principle to the Pharisees of his day and to us today. Matthew chapter 23. Change must first come from within. There are many people in the world, many men and businessmen who have business ethics, and they are courteous even, and they are well cultured and intelligent, and they dress very well. But that in itself does not mean that they are on a path of righteousness. Does not mean that they are even on a path of truth. They're well-cultured, well-educated, enlightened, well-reformed. But there's something that is within that is amiss. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 25, I read 25 through 28. The Bible says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye may clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Thou blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is when? Within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For ye are like unto whitened sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanness. Even so ye all also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity." We can be thorough reformers in regards to health, dress, or any other aspect of our lives and still end up in a lake of fire. What's the condition of your heart? How is it with you in secret places? When no one else is around, when no one else is looking but the recording angel. How do you act in your homes? Again, you can be thorough in your reform. You can understand present truth to its fullest. A quotation that I often shrivel over is 5T, page 213 and 214, where the prophet of God says, not everyone who professes to keep the Sabbath will be sealed. There are many, even among those who teach the truth to others, who will not receive the seal of God in their forehead. They had the light of truth. They understood their master's will. They knew every point of our faith, but they had not corresponding works. So you can understand the truth perfectly, every single point of our faith, and still be lost. And as Jesus said to the Pharisees of his day, they have passed over the weightier matters of the law. And we need to understand those weightier matters, those things that are critical, and it's not my purpose right now to go into those. But change must come from within. We must be pleading with God for that deliverance. I find myself getting frustrated so easily. That's a problem I need to deal with. Under stress and pressure, I can't handle it. That's something I need to deal with. Yeah, I may be dressed nice. I don't eat this, that, and the other. But I'm on a path to destruction. Jesus says you're a hypocrite. Amen. And we need to be on our guards that we do not be hypocrites, actors, putting on a front, deceiving our own selves. Change must come from within, friends. Cleansing the outside of the cup will never make the vessel pure within. A nominal acceptance of truth is good as far as it goes. And the ability to give a reason for our faith, praise God for that, is good, is a good accomplishment. But if the truth, do you have the love of the truth? If the truth does not go deeper than this, the soul will never be saved. It's a serious heart work here. And we don't have time to lose. Serious heart work. The heart must be purified from how much of its moral defilement? All. I know you know these things already. But blessed are ye that do them. Dress is an index of what? The mind and heart. What is an index to your mind and heart? Dress. That which is hung upon the outside is a sign, the sign of that which is within. Now, this doesn't mean how you may dress in your homes or something. This is how you normally dress and carry yourself. How you dress is an index of your mind state. The outside appearance is frequently an index to the mind, and we should be careful what signs. You know, we are being watched. In fact, we are spectacles, right? To men and angels. People are watching us, especially as we profess to be people of the book, people of present truth. And the only movement that will go until the end. Do we look like the rest of the world? Do we make our profession palatable by how we present ourselves? What sign do we give? And we should be careful what signs we hang out for the world to judge our faith. A person's character is judged by his style of dress, a refined taste. A cultivated mind will be revealed in a choice of simple and appropriate attire. Chaste simplicity in dress, when united with modesty of demeanor, will go far forward toward surrounding a young woman with the atmosphere of sacred reserve, which will be to her a shield from a thousand perils. I want to share with you a brief example, experience of a young lady. You may have heard of this young lady by the name of Amy McKnight. And I decided to put it up here so that you can read her story, her little story with me. An experience that she had that perhaps because of her dress and appearance, her life was spared. The experience of Amy McKnight. I was home on a holiday and needed to earn some money. I had some books, a car, my Cole Porter ministry, and determination. I decided to try knocking on some doors in a neighborhood near my home. It was cold outside, and after visiting many homes, I decided to stop by a large indoor apartment complex. Of course, hindsight being 2020, I should have called my mother to let her know where I was going. In fact, I probably should have just skipped the apartments altogether and knocked on the doors of more houses. The cars in the parking lot weren't very nice, but I decided to go in anyway. It definitely wasn't the smartest decision I ever made. I started from the top of the building and worked my way down. I sold some books and had some good experiences, but my experience at the last door on the ground floor totally overshadowed everything else. The light seemed to be out on the first floor, and the hallway was dark. I knocked on the door and just waited. I heard some rustling behind the door and could see someone peeking out of the peephole. I smiled and waved, letting them know how friendly I was. The door opened wide, and a male voice said from behind the door, "Come in." I had been so exhilarated by the other experiences that I was ignoring all the warnings I'd learned in training. As I looked around the place, I didn't see any toys. I didn't see any signs of a woman or anyone else. Those are things that we learn in canvassing. I didn't even see the person who had opened the door. Still, I walked into the open living room, and seconds later, I heard the door shut and latch behind me. When I turned around, I knew I was in the kind of trouble that only God could get a person out of. The man was standing by the door, dressed only in his boxer shorts and brandishing what looked like a knife in his hand. I took a quick look around and realized there was no way out. All I could do was send a prayer to heaven, put on my biggest smile, and start doing what I come there for. "Hi," I said cheerfully. "My name is Amy. I'm a student working my way through Christian school. Instead of junk food or magazines, we decided we could give you something a little more special. Why don't you take a look?" As the last words left my mouth, I stretched out my arm to hand him a book. He looked at me up and down and asked me to say it again, and I did. This time I asked him what type of books he liked to read. "Magazines," he answered. So I pulled out a copy of God's Answer to Your Questions and started my canvas. God's Answers to Your Questions answer some of the most commonly asked questions about the Bible, like what happens when you die and if Jesus is really coming again. He looked interested. So I tried again. "Here, take a look." He put the knife down on a table behind him and reached for the book. Praise God. I eagerly gave it to him and started my close. In bookstores, a book like this would sell for about $15, but people have been helping out with about $10. He started to say he didn't have any money, but I cut him off and told him that if he promised to read it, I would give it to him for free. He said he would. I asked for his name, told him I would pray for him, and he unlocked the door and let me be on my way. When I got outside the building, I knew I had been really close to becoming some awful statistic. But I also knew that God was with me the whole time, and the sun couldn't have been shining brighter on that overcast day. That day I wore my pea coat, but underneath I had on an ankle-length skirt and sensible brown shoes. My face bore no makeup, and my hair was simple. Looking back, I truly believe my appearance and attire, along with the help of my guardian angels, were what prevented that man from doing the wicked things that seemed to be on his mind. I made sure to mention that I was a Christian student working my way through school, and I looked the part because I intentionally dressed with witnessing in mind. Let us talk about the importance of dress reform and health. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 3. Perhaps later on, or maybe Sabbath, I will share a little bit more of her story and how she used to live. Genesis chapter 3. This is a very critical point that I want to make here in the beginning here. When it comes to dress reform and health, we can recall the fact that our first parents sinned. And as a result of their sin, they lost the glory of God. They became naked, and they knew they were naked. And what did they seek to do to hide their nakedness? To sew fig leaves, to cover themselves. But God came and clothed them. And here in Genesis 3, verse 21, we read about that. And the Lord God said, behold, 21, unto Adam also and to his wife. That's the point that I want to drive home. Unto Adam and to his wife. Did God just clothe the woman? Who else did he clothe? So in understanding, when we're dealing with dress reform, we're not just talking about women. We're talking about men as well. This is a human thing that we're dealing with. Unto Adam and unto his wife, the Bible says, that the Lord God made coats of skins and clothed them. So that's something I want to start off with as we deal with the subject of dress reform. The principles that we will cover, perhaps in the context of addressing women, applies also to men. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians what chapter? 10. This is another basic principle that we need to understand. Well-known passages that I'm sure all of you know by heart. You perhaps may go in your grocery store and you share it with your neighbors. Right? How long are we going to be here, friends? You know, God is waiting to see within his people the character of his son formed. And we are told in inspiration that in order for us to develop a character like Christ, we must participate in his work. That's Desire of Ages 142. And in order for us to enter into his joy, the joy of seeing souls redeemed by his blood, we must participate in the work for their redemption. We must have a burning desire to share these truths with our neighbors, to seek any opportunity we can to be a blessing to someone, to hasten Christ's return. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse what? Anyone can guess? Verse 31. Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Inspiration says, eating, drinking, and what? Dressing. All have a direct bearing upon our spiritual advancement. She includes dressing in this as well. The importance of dress and health reform. Eating, drinking, and dressing have a direct bearing upon our spiritual advancement. And if we want to spiritually advance, we must not only consider what we eat and drink, but also how we dress. We are all called upon to lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us, that we may be able to run the Christian race without embarrassment and obtain the crown of immortal glory. That's what we are aiming for, all to the glory of God. And I mention these, by the way, because we have to learn to avoid extremes, by the way. And I'm not going to go into all the extremes that exist when it comes to dress reform, because, again, I don't have that time. But I want to just touch on a slight principles in dealing with extremes. As we go along, I'll bring some of it out. Ministers and people must make greater advancement in the work of reform. They should commence without delay to correct their wrong habits of eating, drinking, dressing, and working. That is something that I really have been taking to heart, especially going more through this, is helping me to remember temperance in all things, eating, drinking, dressing, and working. I saw that quite a number of the ministers are not awake upon this important subject. Quite a number of who? ministers, leaders of God's people are not awake to this important subject. It's not my words. Here's another one. Perhaps no question has ever come up among us which has caused such development of character as has the dress reform. What? You mean to tell me things such as perhaps even diet at the time was not a subject that would have caused more character development? Or perhaps what else, what it was in their days? She says that no other subject, no, perhaps no question has ever come up that has caused so much development of character. Now the question that we may ask is, why is this? Why do you think, at least in her days, there was perhaps no other question that would cause, that would not cause more character development than dealing with dress reform? Why do you think that would have been the case? What was that?
Pride.
Vanity. Though that has its place, in context is actually because of extremes. And that same principle, of course, can be applied to anything that we may teach. We cause issues and we get into fights and battles, which has some bearing on our character development. How I dress is how you should dress. That's a development issue. And in her time, of course, Lord's willing, Sabbath, we'll go into more of the history. There was a lot of, how can I say it, agitation, extreme positions, issues being pushed. If you don't see it as it is, you're not a reformer. I want to read a little bit of the context of that to help you understand what I'm saying and why I say it was extremes. Much unhappy feeling was created by those who were constantly urging the reformed dress upon their sisters. With extremists, this reform seemed to constitute the sum and substance of their religion. That's all they talked about. We must be careful of extremes. Whatever the particular subject may be, the gospel is broad. The three angels' messages, we need to understand the principles of it, but if we harp on one particular point and nail it in and hammer it in, we will be in danger of going to an extreme. And dress reform is one of them. It was the theme of conversation and the burden of their hearts, and their minds were thus diverted from God and the truth. They failed to cherish the Spirit of Christ. That's what goes back to what I've discussed at the beginning, a change from within. You can be thoroughly converted in regards to principles, in regards to the truth, but still not have the Spirit of Christ. Do you know that there have been many people who have been pushed from the truth, not because of the truth, but because of how it was presented? Why do I want to deal with this? And by the way, if that has been you, be not discouraged. You're not here for man, but for Christ. And recognize where he leads you. Recognize where you are and make sure it's where he wants you. Because there will be people who will let you down, people who will disappoint you, people with attitude who may rub you the wrong way. Man is fallen, errant, and bound to err. Unless we keep our eyes fixed and stayed on Christ, we will end up like Peter and begin to sink. Who began to look at the issues that were surrounding him, rather than focusing on him who is the author and finisher of his faith. So again, this is the context. They don't have the Spirit of Christ and manifested a great lack of true courtesy. Instead of prizing the dress for its real advantages, they seem to be proud of its singularity. Perhaps no question And then that's the rest of that text. In order to secure the most healthful clothing, the needs of every part of the body. How many parts of the body? The needs of every part of your body. In order to secure the most healthful clothing, the needs of every part of the body must be carefully studied. The character of the climate. Again, we're dealing with extremes. That's why I share this text. The character of the climate, the surroundings, the condition of health, the age, and the occupation must all be considered. So how you dress here may not be the same that you may dress here in another situation. But we need to consider the principles and apply them where we are. But again, avoid extremes. An almost endless train, and this is what's going to segue me in to my next section. An almost endless train of disease results from unhealthful modes of what? Dress. An almost endless train of diseases are a result of how we dress. Wow. Do you think we need to understand this a little more? And careful instruction on this point should be given. So let's deal with dress reform and health. Now, from a physiological point of view, from how your body functions, what does perfect health depend upon? All right, you guys have been studying. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 17. Leviticus chapter 17. And notice what the Bible here tells us in what verse? 11. Leviticus chapter 17 and verse 11. Well-known passage. One that we would be well to remember, young man, and commit it to your mind. Put God's word in your heart, right?
Yeah.
And remember them. They're so precious. You want God's word. Everything else in this world will fail you, but God will never fail you. Remember that, okay? God's word won't fail. Leviticus chapter 17 and verse 11. The Bible says, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul." So the life of the flesh is in the blood. And as I heard from a few of you, perfect health depends upon perfect blood or perfect circulation of the blood. Inspiration says, the more active the circulation, the more free will be the blood from obstructions and impurities. The blood nourishes the body. The health of the body depends upon the healthful circulation of the blood. Now, in order for your blood to be invigorated or full of life, of course, that has to do with what we eat, sunlight, water, etc. But what good it is for us to have perhaps clean blood or pure blood if that blood is not able to circulate as it should? They go hand in hand. Eating, drinking, and dressing, we read earlier, all have a direct bearing upon our spiritual advancement. Now, what was the purpose of Adam and Eve's garment that God gave them? When he came and he clothed them, what was that purpose? We read earlier in Genesis 3:21, the Lord God made coats of skins and clothed them, Adam and Eve, man and woman. But what was the purpose for which God clothed them? To cover their nakedness. What was that? I heard something else. Okay, to cover them. Okay, because of the consequences of sin.
For a good blood circulation also.
There we go. I'm sorry, let me read this one first of all. At every pulsation of the heart, the blood should be propelled to the extremities quickly and easily in order to have health. The current of human life is struggling to go its accustomed rounds and should not be hindered in its circuit through the body by the imperfect manner in which women clothe their limbs, or men for that matter. Now, dealing with Adam and Eve, we're told that this is why they were clothed. The atmosphere, by the way, I believe in climate change. And I believe that it's been changing since our parents were kicked out of the garden. In fact, inspiration clarifies that for me. The atmosphere, once so mild and uniform in temperature, was now subject to marked changes. And the Lord mercifully provided them with a garment of skins as a protection from the extremes of heat and cold. So God clothed them, yes, because they were naked. Yes, as a result of sin, to cover that nakedness. But he was seeking to guard them from the extremes of the weather. Here's another one. The atmosphere was changed. It was no longer unvarying as before. It wasn't varying before this. God clothed them with coats of skins to protect them from the sense of chilliness and then of heat. Not only from the cold, but from the heat as well, to which they were exposed. The Bible talks about a virtuous woman. In Proverbs 31, let's go there. What is said of a virtuous woman in Proverbs 31, verse 21? Proverbs 31, what verse? 21. The Bible says this of a virtuous woman. She is not afraid of the snow for her household. She's not afraid of the what? I hear some still turning, so I'll wait. Proverbs 31 and verse 21. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her household are clothed with scarlet. Now, I'm reading from the King James. Some of you may have another version, but then again, you may not. But if there is anyone here who have another version, how does it render? Or perhaps if you have a margin, what does it say anything in a margin?
Double garments.
Double garments. That word actually used there is a reference to double garments that she clothed her household with. That's why the context talks about snow. In fact, several other versions say that. The easy-to-read version talks about, it says she does not worry about her family when it snows. She has given them all good, warm clothes. With scarlet, that time was used, was thick material, nice material that kept you warm. It was very rich. She doesn't worry when it snows because her family has warm clothing, or as it says here in a good word, double layer of clothing. A few other versions that bring that out. Now let's go to inspiration. Perfect health depends upon perfect circulation. Special attention should be given to what? The extremities. Now, extremities have to do with your legs, your feet, your arms, your hand. Oftentimes, she mentions limbs. But special attention should be given to those parts of the body that they may be as thoroughly clothed as the chest and the region over the heart. Really? Where there is the greatest amount of heat. And we'll unpack this a little bit, Lord's willing. If these parts are not so warm as the body, the circulation is not what?
Equalized.
And again, we want perfect circulation. We want our circulation to be equalized throughout the body at all times. But if there's more warmth in the chest area or where the major organs are, then of course that's where most of the blood is. And it's not being equalized or flowing through the whole system as it should. When the extremities, which are remote from the vital organs, are not properly clogged, the blood is driven to what? The head, causing headache or nosebleed. Or there is a sense of fullness about the chest, causing you to cough. producing cough and palpitation of the heart on account of too much blood in that locality. Or the stomach has too much blood, causing indigestion. Perfect health depends on perfect circulation. You can have good blood by eating good food, but if you're dressed wrong, you're defeating the purpose. Now, just a little bit about the arteries and the veins. We know the arteries, the main vessels that transport blood from the heart to the rest of the body. They're bigger, they're deeper. The arteries used to transport blood throughout the body. And then you have the veins that brings the blood from the different parts of the body back to the heart. And the artery, of course, are bigger than the veins. For every artery, there are two veins bringing the blood back. In order for the blood to circulate as it should, if there's more blood in our chest area, then when the blood goes out, when the extremities become cold, that is a result of there being too much blood in the chest area where the main organs are. And as the blood leaves and goes to these extremities, and those extremities are cold, then when the blood returns, it's also cold, which slows down that circulation and makes it even poorer. You may ask the question, why do we lose our elasticity, especially as we get older? Why do we lose our elasticity? Why do we get stiffer as we tend to get older? Why do these joints ache? Why do our brains become foggy and congested? And we suffer from heart, lung, and liver diseases. Now, of course, there may be various factors, but it's actually largely due to poor circulation. Amen. The limbs and feet have large veins to receive a large amount of blood. That warmth, nutrition, elasticity, and strength may be imparted to them. But when the blood is chilled from these extremities, because improper clothing of them, when they are chilled from these extremities, their blood vessels contract, which makes the circulation of the necessary amount of blood in them still more difficult. Are you following so far? A good circulation preserves the blood pure and secures health. A bad circulation leaves the blood to become impure and induces congestion of the brain and lungs and causes diseases of the head, the heart, the liver, lungs. Let's move on. When the limbs and arms are chilled, the blood is driven from these parts to the lungs and head. The circulation is impeded, and nature's fine machinery does not move harmoniously. The limbs were not formed by our Creator to endure exposure, as was the face. The Lord provided large veins and nerves for the limbs and feet to contain a large amount of the current of human life, that the limbs might be uniformly as warm as the body. They should be so thoroughly clothed as to induce the blood to the extremities. Now, I've read several quotations here, but I want to make a note briefly. And I'll get more into this if I have time today, if not, next time. But a question is often, or I should say a statement is often made about when it's hot outside. I don't want to be more hot when it's outside. But the question you must be asking yourself is, why exactly are you hot? Exactly. Is it because of the weather? Or is it because of how we dress? Now, of course, temperature does matter. Don't get me wrong. But I've often said, when someone has told me it's cold outside, I said, well, let me remember my saying. It's not that it's cold outside as it is that you're not properly dressed. We can dress for the weather. Now, hot or heat, we think that if we wear less in the heat, we will be cooler. But actually, when you understand the physiology of the body, and especially how the blood circulates, I'll put it like this, in the summer, would it make sense for us to go outside with perhaps things on our arms and legs and nothing over our chest area? In other words, just the opposite of what men and women do. Why not just leave the chest area all? I mean, there are people who do that, by the way. They don't, they just completely unclothe. But why is it that we mostly put on shirts and perhaps a little pant and leave the extremes open? Why not the reverse? Oftentimes people ask me, why do you wear that when it's so hot outside? And whatever it is I'm wearing. I might not have on a full suit, but I'm wearing clothes and they think, aren't you hot? I say, no, because all my clothing is equally purported. My circulation keeps going, and so my temperature doesn't rise. But when my circulation isn't going as it should, yeah, my temperature's going to rise. Is it because it's trying to become back in balance? Now, of course, we have to understand that we can't be foolish out in extreme hot weather and go out with a full coat on and et cetera, white clothes that are decent for the summer. But it has more to do with the circulation of the blood than it does the temperature outside. I just wanted to make that note. The extremities are chilled, and the heart has thrown upon it double labor to force the blood into these chilled extremities. And when the blood has performed its circuit through the body and returned to the heart, it is not the same vigorous warm current which left it. It has been chilled in its passage through the limbs. The heart, weakened by too great labor and poor circulation of poor blood, is then compelled to still greater exertion to throw the blood to the extremities, which are never as healthily warmed as other parts of the body. The heart fails in its efforts, and the limbs become habitually cold. And the blood, which is chilled away from the extremities, is thrown back upon the lungs and brain. And inflammation and congestion of the lungs or the brain is the result. So many results of how we dress. Another great cause of mortality among infants and youth is the custom of leaving their arms and shoulders naked. This fashion cannot be too severely censored. It has cost the life of how many? Thousands. The air bathing the arms and limbs and circulating about the armpits chills these sensitive portions of the body so near the vitals and hinders the healthy circulation of the blood and induces disease, especially of the lungs and brain. And we have an epidemic of asthma, which is not just food related. And we have ADHD, but it's not just food or atmosphere related. It's also how we're dressing our youth. I want to look at a few health ailments of exposed limbs to cold specifically. There's been some research done on animals and humans who have been given cold treatment by placing them in cold water or even refrigerated rooms to check out the physiological effect that it produces. And here are some of the results that I'm just going to go through And I'm going to spend not too much time on it, but these have been documented results of the effects, at least of having extremes exposed to coldness or chilliness. Stomach. The stomach was found to have acute erosions leading to ulcers in cold stress animals. Kidneys. Cold was found to cause nepherosclerosis. The nephrons become hardened, so they cannot filter properly or return what they should to the system. The liver, fatty infiltration of the liver is a regular result of cold stress and is similar to alcohol damage. Brain and nervous system. Cold causes congestion and edema of the brain. Edema of the brain is like having a concussion. The area starts to swell and you see a loss of function and definitely headache. If sufficiently severe and prolonged, hemorrhages and bleeding results. The spleen. Cold exposure in rats caused a marked decrease in the size of the spleen as well as in all the lymph nodes and lymph organs. And this is your immune system, of course, the immunity against disease. Heart issues. Exposure to the cold caused vessels to constrict, placing an increased load on the heart as well as palpitations, and we read about that earlier. Thyroid. A prolonged cold taxes the thyroid gland, possibly raises the basic metabolic rate. You can increase your energy burning potential, potentially trying to keep you warm. If the pituitary gland, the master gland of the body, can be reduced inside testes and seminal vesicles are reduced to about half by cold exposure. Then there's blood pressure. I don't have much time to go through this, but blood pressure, allergies, arthritis can be found to have links to exposure to coldness or chilliness in the extremes. Other than the circulation of the blood, what other function of the body must be free from the obstruction of what we wear? Oh, yes.
Quick question. The list of the complications with the different organs, is that resulting from cold applied to the organ itself or cold extremities decreasing the circulation of those organs?
I think it was to the body itself. I have to go back and look at the specifics. It didn't look like, in other words, they were put in, the ones that were put in the refrigerated rooms, they didn't have any extra coldness applied to them. So it seems like they were the whole body, but their extremes were open rather than the body, the chest area for the humans. But for the cold treatments, they were applied to the extremes. Or cold water, I should say, cold water. So other than the circulation of the blood, there's something else, another function of the body that must be free from the obstruction of what we wear. Every article of dress should fit easily, obstructing neither the circulation of the blood nor a free, full, natural respiration. Your lungs. Now, like I said, Lord's willing, Sabbath, I'll go into some of the history dealing with what's going on in the pioneers' days with hoop dresses and different things that women wore that would constrict their breathing. Everything worn should be so loose that when the arms are raised, the clothing will be correspondingly lifted. Now, I say this especially because I have dealt with people who tell me that I should never wear a belt. I always should wear suspenders. And I believe that, to be honest, that's an extreme position, to say that I should never wear a belt. Because according to the principles that I've read, I've never read where I should never wear a belt. In fact, I'll share later, I'm about to close, but I'll share Lord's willing Sabbath, if I can remember, about things that hang off the hips or the waist and comparing them. But if you wear a belt, it should still be loose and not tight enough to where your organs are being restricted, and that you're not breathing and you're cutting off circulation more to the rest of the body. Should be loose, and loose enough to where if you lift your body still, your shirt and other things easily come out. So loose that when the arms are raised, the clothing will be correspondingly lifted. There was a quotation, I'm not going to share that one here. I'm going to share my closing text. This is the heart of the matter, especially the last one I share right after this. It is not the will of God that men and women should die prematurely, leaving their work unfinished. He would have us live out the full measure of our days, with every organ free to do its allotted work. That's what God wants, every organ free to do its allotted work. Many complain of the providences of God when disease and death remove members of the household, but it is unjust to charge God with what is but the sure result of their own transgression of natural laws. Amen. And finally, to those having had the light upon the subject of eating and dressing with simplicity, in obedience to moral and physical laws, still turn from the light, which points out their duty, will shun duty in other things. By shunning the cross, which they would have to take up in order to be in harmony with natural law, they blunt the conscience, and they will, to avoid reproach, violate the Ten Commandments.
Where does the quote from?
Christian Church Bible.
Yes. Page 159. So if we blunt our conscience in regards to nature's laws, then we will give in to the mark of the beast. Amen. It's that easy. Yes.
So then it was something, we need sunshine to penetrate our skin. How are we going to do it?
You can take sunbaths. I mean, if that's proper.
It's very important.
Mm-hmm. Right. And that's a whole nother aspect of it. That's why I say you have to be temperate and modest. Now, I will get into modesty later on. You can't take extremes and say never not expose your limbs or your body for that matter. How do you get body to your chest? I mean, sun to your chest. I mean, we don't just walk out in the open with our chest open, but we need to get sunlight to that part too. So we need to understand, be wise in it, and make sure they were modest and take appropriate sun baths, etc. My closing thought, what about the modesty of health reform? What about my pants or skirt or blouse? What about my earrings or wedding band? What about head coverings? And what was the American costume and a reformed dress in the pioneer's days all about? Well, Lord's willing, we'll look more into those Sabbath morning by God's grace. But may we be true reformers. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you for your spirit of prophecy, which has been given through us throughout time and given to us also in these last days. And Father, we pray that we will take to heart all that you teach us throughout this week and the weeks to come, as you're seeking to prepare us to stand before your throne without fault, and that being without a mediator. So help us to this end. In Jesus' name, amen.